Hi, I'm Chris Sarandon, and welcome to Cooking by Heart, where we talk about the vivid memories of the food we grew up with and the people and the stories attached to that time in our lives. My guest today is the incomparable Diane English. Diane English created, wrote, and executive produced the groundbreaking comedy Murphy Brown, which ran for 10 seasons on CBS and for which she received 3 Emmy Awards and 2 Writers Guild of America Awards for outstanding writing in a comedy series. Over the course of its run, Murphy Brown garnered 62 Emmy Award nominations, 18 Emmy Awards, 2 for Best Comedy Series, and a Golden Globe Award for Best Comedy Series. Murphy Brown returned to CBS in 2018 with English, also returning as the showrunner and executive producer. She has also written a column on television for Vogue magazine and co-wrote PBS's adaptation of Ursula K. Le Guin's novel, The Lathe of Heaven, for which she received her first of 5 Writers Guild of America Award nominations. English has also created the critically acclaimed comedy series Foley Square for CBS and executive produced and wrote the CBS series My Sister Sam. Among her additional television comedy series, English has created Love and War. She was the creator of Inc. and co-creator of a show called Double Rush, all on CBS, and was co-creator of Living in Captivity on the Fox network. Diane also wrote, produced, and directed the feature film The Women, for which English received Women in Film's prodigious Crystal Award and the MMPA's Diversity Award for Best Adapted Screenplay. In 2011, she received the WGA's highest honor, the Patty Chayefsky Award. Ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy and thrilled to finally be talking to Diane English. Hi, Diane.
Hi, Chris. Finally, we got this technology working on our side.
Yes, we did. We had a quite adventurous day yesterday trying to get through to each other. I always start the show with provenance, where we're from, because I think it has a lot to do with food and the way we grew up. You grew up in Buffalo?
Yeah, I grew up in Buffalo, New York, and my whole family is still there.
Oh, yeah?
I'm the only one that left. When the moving van came to take me away, it was like a spaceship had landed in the neighborhood. No one ever leaves. I don't understand. But yeah, I go back several times a year, and my mom just turned 99.
Wow.
So have very good reason to go back,
of course,
as frequently as I can.
Right. Now, siblings?
Yeah, I have one brother who's younger than me by 6 years.
Is he still there?
Yes, he's still there. Everybody is still there.
Still there.
Literally the only one
yes,
who left.
Exactly. Now, lest we be accused of disparaging Buffalo, I've been there a couple of times. And I remember a few years ago, my daughter and her husband, they're both in the private school teaching area, and they were offered jobs at a school in Buffalo, a private school, and they just thought the city was spectacular. Great deal of cultural amenities available. It's close to the Canadian border. It's close to so many wonderful things, including also they have a great football team, et cetera, et cetera. So
Buffalo's,
yeah, right, great town. But not a town that is necessarily commensurate with one's show business or journalistic aspirations, I would think.
Yeah.
But first, let's talk about your family, and then we'll get into that as well. So, mom, dad, tell me about them.
So, mom is Italian, second generation.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
So I'm half, mm-hmm. and on the other side, on my father's side, English, Scottish, Irish.
Right.
Made for very interesting family dinners.
Well, that's we're going to get there definitely. Dad did what?
He was an electrical engineer, and he worked for the Niagara Mohawk Power Company because mm-hmm. Niagara Falls and Buffalo are right next to each other.
Right.
And my mom, you know, was a pretty much stay-at-home mom, but you know, raised us kids, but also had part-time jobs because she loved to get out of the house and do things. But she was an aspiring vocalist. You know, she was in high school, she was a member of her two girlfriends formed a group called the Toon Triplets, and they did local USO tours. And then she did some war bonds advertisements that were in movie theaters. But when she got married, my dad said, no more performing for you.
No show business.
So she had to really wait until she was in her late 40s and they divorced, that she went ahead and really built herself a nice career.
Interesting how, and this oddly sort of parallels something that my mother went through, not from a performing standpoint, but just from being under, for want of a better word, under the thumb of my dad, who was a Greek immigrant and very much an old-fashioned guy in a lot of ways when it came to his relationship with her. And she was much younger. But it wasn't until they divorced that she finally found her, for want of a better word, calling in life. And she ended up having a great time the second half of her life.
Yeah, same, you know. And my mom ultimately remarried, and you know, but she you know, had her own band, and you know, was well known in Buffalo. Your wife Joanna knows her, and her sing, and you know, and so you know, her second half was very different from her first half. But it's not an uncommon story for women of that era.
Yeah.
You know, she was born in the 1920s, you know.
And, exactly. And my mom was too.
In the 1940s, so yeah, same.
Yeah. So mom was at home. She cooked. Yeah. Did she cook Italian?
Listen, we grew up in a two-family home that was built in 1902 for the Pan American Exposition.
Mm.
My grandparents, her parents, lived in the apartment below, and our family was in the apartment above. And so there was a lot of intermingling, but...
Paternal or maternal grandparents?
The maternal.
Maternal. So the Italian.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so my grandmother was an amazing cook. And so my mom really never learned to cook because she didn't have to. And so our meals, and I know my mom's listening to this, so I apologize, but I'll get to the good part later. She was not a good cook. And so our meals, I remember, it's like green vegetables were cooked till they were yellow.
Yes.
Steak was cooked till it was like shoe leather.
Yes.
You know, and there was like a very small repertoire of meals. But then ultimately, when she remarried a man who wanted to open a restaurant. He was a really good cook, and that's where she learned to cook. And now it's become, for the second half of her life, a fantastic cook. Unfortunately, we moved
out. You didn't
out,
experience so. That, right? Yeah.
We didn't experience that growing up.
Right.
But growing up, the best thing that happened to me and my brother was when McDonald's opened, because when my parents would go out for dinner, they'd, you know, plop down the sack of hamburgers and french fries, and we were thrilled. So, you know, but a lot of the meals also were, we just go downstairs, you know, to my grandmother's and often, you know, eat down there. But every Sunday there was a big family meal, Italian, either Italian or go to the paternal family. And there was a whole different kind of meal.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes on holidays they would merge, which was interesting.
Interesting. Yes. Yeah, so first let's talk about this. So then you guys didn't eat communally with your grandparents all the time. There were just certain occasions when you would go back and forth.
Right. So, you know, there was extended family in Buffalo on the Italian side.
Right.
So on every other Sunday, we would go to the apartment downstairs, and my grandmother would have a big table set, and she'd have been cooking all day, and it was either lasagna or spaghetti and meatballs or, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
And the whole house filled, you know, with that aroma. And, you know, it was just great, you know, but, you know, typically they never want to share the recipe because that's their job and purpose in life.
Yeah.
And if you know how to do it, they're fired from their job.
Right.
So really never, by the time I got downstairs to see how she was making that sauce, it was made already. I don't know what time she got up, probably in the dark, you know, to do it.
Yeah. And always better when it's been simmered for a while anyway. So.
Oh, for a day.
Yeah, at least. Yeah. So then there would be these big gatherings downstairs with your grandparents on Sundays and or certain holidays. Holidays were that was that an Italian Christmas or was it an English Christmas?
It was an Italian Christmas and a Christmas Eve too.
Yeah,
you know, fish.
Right,
and then Easter was the other side of the family. Normally, now my dad's sister and mother lived together in what was then a growing suburb of Buffalo called Orchard Park, which football fans might recognize as the home of the Buffalo Bills, and made headlines this year for having 7 feet of snow in 24 hours.
Right.
So, but they had a little tiny house with a little tiny kitchen, and they ran a bakery and a restaurant.
Hmm.
James Beard got his Christmas cookies from my aunt every year.
Wow.
I mean, she was that amazing. And again, of that era, you know, she probably would have been like a Food Network star if it was now,
yeah,
you know.
Exactly.
But we would go there on alternate Sundays or on Easter and have usually like a standing rib roast, Yorkshire pudding, and fabulous mashed potatoes. And the Easter baskets were like nothing you've ever seen before. The kids all got these unbelievable Easter baskets. She had antique molds for rabbits and chickens that were pure chocolate and dressed in actual clothing.
What?
That these ladies made that worked for her, and they wore little wire rimmed glasses, the chocolate bunny.
What a wonderful image.
Baskets were, I mean, I'm telling you, they were such works of art. The little chocolate nests were made of dark chocolate and coconut, hand scraped the coconuts.
Yep.
And jelly beans for eggs. And I mean, we looked forward to that every year, you know, because I mean, if we had had camera phone, you know, we would have photographed each one.
Snapping
and it's
away.
Lost now. There's no pictures of this stuff.
But. Mm-hmm. Interesting, too, that, and that's generational to a certain extent. And that is that, for instance, my mom, who sort of trained me as a cook when I was young, because there were no girls in the house and my brother and I were around. My brother wasn't around as much. He was much older. And so I was the sous chef.
Mm-hmm.
But there were no recipes. I basically just watched her and watched the feel of what was going into things and the taste. And and this also occurs. I did interviews with both Jacques Pepin and Lydia Bastianich. And both of them describe growing up very much the same way, both at home and in restaurants. When Jacques Pepin worked in high-end French restaurants, he was never given a recipe. He had to stand by the chef and watch and watch and watch. But not a bad way to go, because essentially food is a dynamic process. Proportions are not necessarily as important as the taste. It's about the taste.
Exactly. And I think the great cooks really have an instinct about things, you know, and I know some amazing cooks who have restaurants who, you know, when somebody says you should write a cookbook, it stymies them because then they have to start writing down recipes that people can follow with measurements.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, baking is a real alchemy. It's very specific. And I was never good at it because I don't really like to do things that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not a good baker, and I come from obviously long line of bakers, but I prefer the Italian method, you know, of a pinch of this and a little bit of that, and then you taste it and see, you know, or just instinctively how you can put something together just from what's in the refrigerator or in the pantry, you know, that you can actually make a pretty interesting meal out of.
Yeah.
I hate throwing food out. So if I'm about to go on a trip, I will open my refrigerator and see what's in there so I don't have to throw
it
away.
Out. Yep.
Whatever it is, it always goes with pasta.
Right. Exactly. Now, was there a difference in the atmosphere in the English and in the Italian meals? that you experienced when you were growing up, just in terms of the talk around the table? What was that like?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, the Italians were, you know, it's my mother and my her brother and his family and the cousins and the grandparents. Mm-hmm. And it was just this big family, loud, and lots of jokes. And when the meal was over, the men went into the living room to either watch a game or play cards.
Yep.
And the women cleared the table and did the dishes and gossiped.
Yes.
And there was no dishwasher. Mm-hmm. And that meal was so messy. We were in there for hours washing pots.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a fun time, you know, to be together.
Well, there's a community and a fellowship that occurs over whatever the task is that you have to accomplish, particularly when it comes to family and food.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's part of it, is either the cooking together or the cleaning up. It's a communal activity. And on the other hand, the English side of the family,
mm-hmm.
The table was smaller, you know, the group was smaller, and it was a little bit more reserved, as you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
There were times when we all got together. And they loved the Italian food. I mean, who doesn't love Italian food? That was always a treat. And we loved the pies and the cakes and the side. So, you know, and everybody got along great. It was just two different tribes, you know, that, you know, came together over a table.
What a wonderful way also to grow up in a multicultural household, because that's the makeup of this country, essentially.
Well, that's how so many of my friends grew up, how many people grew up in Buffalo, my age, because it was such a diverse town. There was Irish and German and Italian and Jewish on my block.
Mm-hmm.
And we all knew each other and we all hung out together you know, and there was a point in time in the 90s when five of us writers from Buffalo had the five top 10 shows on the air.
And
we were all approximately the same age. And some of us went to school together, you know, it was something in the water, or was it that kind of experience that you get growing up there?
Yes.
Where you just experience lots of different types of people,
yes,
and lifestyles,
yes,
and so on.
Exactly, which gives you a much broader experience to draw on when you're actually trying to reproduce it.
Yeah.
Or turn it into art.
Yeah, you create really good, interesting, round characters,
yeah,
rather than stereotypes.
Exactly, you know? Exactly. Did you guys go out at all?
We almost never went out for dinner. We always, if it was somebody's birthday, that would be the only time we would go out, mm-hmm, for dinner.
Any favorite places?
Well, there was a place in Buffalo called the Royal Pheasant, long gone, but that was always my choice because they had a lobster tank. And my mother introduced me to lobster at a young age because she liked to go there on her birthday.
Mm-hmm.
She treated it like it was a very, very special occasion, very special food, and we all got dressed up. You could pick out your lobster from the tank, and probably not the one you got, but
yes, right.
but you know, I have this picture of it in my head. I had red booths and, you know, sort of dim lighting, and it just seemed like a very fancy place. Probably if went back now, it, mm-hmm, wouldn't seem that way.
Yeah, yeah. But like exotic to a child.
Yes, exactly. We did occasionally go out on for fish fries also on Friday nights.
Mm.
That was kind of a tradition in Buffalo because we grew up Catholic. And so you ate fish.
Mm-hmm.
And if we didn't go out, it would be that block of fish. We called it block o' fish. We don't know where it came from. It was in a square block, and it was defrosting on the counter,
mm-hmm,
and smelled the whole house up. And
right,
we hated it so much. And And so sometimes we would just go out to a fish fry, and usually that would be, you know, at a local tavern, and it was just, right. you know, sawdust on the floor, beers kind of thing, mm-hmm. you know, and so that was it. But we did not go out on a regular basis mm-hmm. at all. It was too expensive.
Yes. Yeah. Middle-class family.
Oh, yeah.
Basically. Right. Yeah.
Yes.
I'm also interested because I've heard stories from various guests who have Italian-American backgrounds of what the Christmas meal was like. Was it fish at Christmas?
No, that would be Christmas Eve.
Christmas Eve.
Yeah, that was usually Christmas Eve. And so there would be something. I mean, it's supposed to be the seven fishes, but we, you know, my grandfather was very old school. He loved something called smelts, you know, it was a little fish. Yeah.
Oh, you just completely threw me back right? 60 years. Yeah.
Yeah.
We got smelts all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. He loved if you could get them without any danger of getting some kind of illness after eating them. He loved clams and oysters.
Mm-hmm.
And there'd be maybe some kind of shrimp or something. But we didn't go for the whole seven. You know, that was a bit much.
Right.
But Christmas dinner was my mother's job. So that was a ham.
Oh.
Yeah, a ham with you know, usually rings of pineapple attached to it.
Right.
And then all the sides, you know, the green bean casserole.
Which is very American.
Very American. Yeah. But, you know, but that we would have the English side of the family over, you know, for Christmas.
Yeah,
so
we
did the traditional Christmas ham.
Mm-hmm.
We had a beagle growing up, and he would eat anything. He was in the kitchen the day that my mother and I was helping her, and we took the ham out of the oven, and it slid off the platter, and everyone was in the living room, and it wasn't a big house at all, so you could hear what was going on in the kitchen, and they were all in there having a cocktail, and you could hear the splat, you know, on the floor, and the dog, he took a beat. He couldn't believe his eyes that the ham was on the floor. Anything on the floor was his, you know, so there was this scrambling of dog paw nails on the linoleum, you know, and trying to get the ham before. And we sort of just went, oh, it's the 5-second rule, and put the ham back on the platter. And I don't know if anybody was aware of what had happened in there, but you could definitely hear that splat because it was a big.
Right. Any other memories you have of anything that might have entered the family diet at some point or other that was exotic in any way, that was totally different from what you were used to?
No, I don't think so. I mean, you know, like I said, lobster was the delicacy for us. You know, we lived on a Lake Erie, you know, so our seafood was imported mm-hmm. or it was, you know, frozen.
Freshwater fish.
Freshwater fish like perch or something like that.
Right, right.
But, you know, other than that, it was everybody had that Betty Crocker cookbook, you know, the red and white checkers, you know, cover.
Right, that had the file, that it was the recipes
with the
were,
file. Yep. It was like, the three-hole punch.
Mm-hmm. Thing. Yeah, I had one for a long time.
Yeah, I still have one. and I use their recipe every year for their cranberry orange bread.
Ooh.
Which I highly recommend. Ooh. I think we kind of stuck to what we knew. And it wasn't until I moved to New York that I started to experience different foods.
Right.
Chinese food, Japanese food. These were all totally untried by me
mm-hmm.
until I got there in my early 20s.
Before we get you to New York in your early 20s, did you have any friends whose families ate differently than you and you were invited over?
Oh, yeah. My best friend, Susie Krause, and I were best friends from kindergarten.
Mm.
And she lived about a block and a half away. She grew up in a Jewish household. Her family was Austrian, first generation,
mm.
also lived with grandparents. Her father was a doctor. It was a very sophisticated household, a lot of art. Her mother was a painter.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they listened to classical music. And that's where I was introduced to bagels and lox challah. And boy, did I love that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's still a brunch favorite of mine.
Yes.
And then she would come to our house and get the spaghetti and meatballs, you
right,
know?
Right. Cultural interchange.
Exchange of cultures.
Yes, right. What about school food? What was that like? Did you bring lunch to school? Did you eat lunch at school?
We ate lunch at school that we brought. I mean, we brought our lunch there in grade school.
Right.
And it was, you know, peanut butter and jelly sandwich, mm-hmm. tuna fish, whatever, you know. In high school, we were provided lunch. And it was, you know, now we're in the early 60s, you know, so it was just, you know, some kind of meat patty. And, you know, I don't even remember it. It was just completely forgettable.
Yes. Yes. As most school lunches are. Although these days, interestingly, not so much. Some of the schools have gotten at least more nutritionally adventurous, if not culinarily adventurous.
Well, that's good.
And colleges, I don't know what, well, let's talk about so you're leaving home. Now, wait, you went to college in Buffalo, right?
I did. I stayed there. I tried not to, I did the math on what it was going to cost to go to some of the schools I was accepted at. Mm-hmm. out of town and just decided not to. And, you know, my family certainly couldn't afford that. And I didn't want loans. So I went to school in Buffalo and I majored in education because at that time, no matter what you wanted to be, if you didn't have a teaching degree to fall back on and you were female, you know, you might be in trouble. Yep. So, but that turned out to be a really lucky thing for me to be going to that school because it happened that was the year that a wonderful man named Warren Enters, who was a theater director in New York, renowned, especially known for fixing plays that were in trouble.
His name rings a slight bell for me.
I mean, he was a co-founder of the Cherry Lane Theater and, you know, so he decided he wanted to teach for one semester just to get out of New York. And he chose our school because we had a theater department that was in its infancy. So he had an opportunity to make his mark.
Right.
And I joined that theater group because I liked, I guess I had a little bit of the performer in me from my mom's genes, you know, and that's really what changed my life because he recognized something in me and my ability to write and direct. And he insisted as I graduated that I should go to New York. And, you know, so I taught for one semester just to accumulate a little cash and then off I went.
This is after graduation you taught?
Yes.
For a semester?
I taught for one semester. And in an inner city school.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had enough cash. I thought I had enough cash for a year in New York, but I was sadly mistaken.
Oh, yes, I'll bet. Now, just to digress slightly, because you said you taught in an inner city school. What was that experience like? Because I had a similar experience, not teaching, but performing for inner city students. And it was quite extraordinary. What was yours like?
Yeah, it was a great experience, actually. I really loved it. And I loved my students and they were all disadvantaged and, you know, they had never put on a play. And they were in need of some money to fix the gym. And I suggested to the principal that maybe we do a play and, you know, charge nominal admission and run it for a couple of days and see what kind of cash we could raise. And so we chose Little Abner because it was a musical and they had a nice little band, you know, and because you could make your own costumes and the rights were really inexpensive.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got all of my students involved in this. And honestly, it just opened up worlds for them that they as theater does for people that they didn't know existed. And a couple of them have gone on to have careers in the theater.
Oh, how great.
Yeah. So But, you know, that was really exciting. I mean, you know, we had kids painting a backdrop, you know, from the art department, and then the band had to learn the music mm-hmm. and, you know, put it all together. And we raised a fair amount of money. It was really great, you know, and for a brief moment, I thought maybe I'm doing the wrong thing by leaving here. But ultimately, I did.
Right. History is better for your having moved on, I must say.
Thank you.
So it's directly to New York. Why New York? What drew you to New York City?
I had visited it once, twice, actually. Once with my mom when I was about 13, where she and a girlfriend and her girlfriend's daughter, who was my age, just decided they were going to take a little road trip and put us kids in the back seat and drove to New York. And we stayed there for about 2 days. And I think the adults found it very overwhelming. To me, this was where I was going to go. Mm-hmm. You know, I loved every minute of it. I remember going to Horn and Hard Arts, you know, you could get pie out of that little, put a quarter in or a dime or whatever it was.
Yeah. And that was what my dad's first job when he came to this country was at Horn and Hard Arts. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah. We walked along Broadway, and Broadway at that time, Times Square was just, you know, a cesspool, but, you know, all of the marquees and the lights and, you know, I'm 13 years old, but, you know, I'm like, this is for me.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went home and I never forgot about it. And then in high school, our senior trip was, and I went to an all girls Catholic school. So there's 50 of us. And some nuns, and we went to New York on our by train on our our senior trip because the World's Fair was on.
Ah.
And so we went to the World's Fair. One of my girlfriends and I had been obsessed with The Tonight Show starring Johnny Carson, and we kind of snuck off one day and we went over to 30 Rock to see if we could get in and meet Johnny Carson. Mm. I mean, like 17 years old.
Right.
And we actually got as far as the floor that The Tonight Show was on. And the doors open, and there was that big marquee with a receptionist desk at The Tonight Show. And mm-hmm. we walked over and said, we'd like to see Johnny Carson if he's around. We're from Buffalo. We're just touring. And
it's only a couple of 17-year-olds from Buffalo could get away with. Yeah.
So, you know, but again, it was just solidified my, you know, my feelings that mm-hmm. that's where I had to go. And then in college, we had so many students from New York and the New York area. And we were all in the theater group together. So I knew I was going at some point.
So you just pack up your bags and head south. Straight down the thruway. And you're in New York City.
My brother and I, I rented a U-Haul because it was one of those little ones you drive, you know, and he had never been to New York. And he was, how old was he? 16, I think, you know, and we went together. I drove. I had very little to take with me, but couple pieces of furniture and stuff.
Yeah,
I had already gone ahead for a week and rented a studio apartment.
Mm.
And then we drove there together and he stayed for a couple of days and we saw Shakespeare in the Park and you know, it was great. You know, I had literally no money by the time I paid my rent, you know, and I couldn't afford a phone. You know, so if you wanted to contact me, you would have to leave a note on my mailbox mm-hmm. in the lobby of my building. But I look back on that time as just one of the happiest times of my life. You know, just the whole world was in front of me.
Exactly.
And I didn't, you know, have any, I didn't have any fear, you know, about what I was doing.
Yes.
Yeah. I didn't really know anybody. I knew one person and I didn't have a job, you know, and I didn't care.
And at that time in our lives, we don't know what we don't know.
Yes, it's a good state.
It's a good state to be in.
Yeah.
When you're starting out, and rather than succumb to what could happen and I can't do this, it's basically what the hell, you know, what else am I going to do with my life? Why not plow ahead?
Exactly. Try it. You're at that point where you don't have responsibilities to children or spouses or, you know, anything that's going to hold you back. Mm-hmm. So it was the time to do it.
And So you started job hunting, obviously.
I started job hunting. And I remember going over to CBS and saying, I'd like to work for the Mary Tyler Moore Show.
Just
they said, how fast can you type? And by the way, the Mary Tyler Moore Show shoots in Los Angeles. I wound up, because I was a writer, so I was a very good typist. And so it turns out that was a good skill to have. So I wound up landing a job in public television, WNET 13, actually first NET, which was the parent company.
Right.
And I worked there for a couple of years, very low pay, as you can imagine. It was public television.
Mm-hmm.
But it was my first exposure to how TV and theater and film could merge, because I was working for Jack Venza in the Theater in America department. Mm. I wound up being his secretary.
Mm-hmm.
And he was quite demanding. And honestly, I was a terrible secretary, but he was very patient. And I met a lot of people there, Bo Goldman, and, you know, I learned to read scripts, and, you know, it was an
apprenticeship in a way.
It definitely was.
Yeah.
One of my jobs before that one was I was answering fan mail written to Big Bird. So I wrote in the voice of Big Bird, you know, responded to these kids.
Yes.
I ultimately transferred to another department that was just starting out called the Television Laboratory. Michael Schamberg had a group there called Guerrilla Television, and they were experimenting with little handheld video cameras.
Ooh.
You know, up until that point,
right. All
the cameras were big, hulking, and the
huge.
Wheels were huge.
Right.
And they had done this great documentary about the 1972 Republican convention, and they snuck in there with these little cameras. Nobody took them seriously, and they made a great award-winning documentary.
Mm-hmm.
One of my jobs there was to write grant proposals for artists. Palabolas, the dance theater, mm-hmm. you know, we worked with all of them. Nam June Paik, who was just a very renowned video artist, mm-hmm. doing his work there. So really interesting place to be. And I was writing the grant proposals, and apparently had a real talent for it, because I was able to convince people to part with their money, you know, like Ford Foundation and so on.
Right.
And so while I was there, the people who ran it, David Loxton, one of them, may he rest in peace. They proposed doing the first television movie that PBS had ever done.
Mm.
And it was an adaptation of Ursula K. Le Guin's award-winning novel called The Lathe of Heaven,
mm-hmm.
science fiction, or speculative fiction, as she called it.
Mm-hmm.
And they had hired a fancy screenwriter from New York or Los Angeles rather. And he turned in multiple drafts, and they were just weeks away from shooting, and they were very unhappy. And they gave me the script to read and said, just give us some notes, you know, because we're going to have to pull this thing together. And so I took it home and I read it, and I knew what to do with it. And so I rewrote it. I wasn't asked to do that,
mm-hmm.
but it was easier than writing all these little notes
in
the margin. And that's the script they shot.
Wow.
And then there was an arbitration through the Writers Guild. And so I got shared credit. And then we got that first Writers Guild Award nomination mm-hmm. for it. And I didn't have an agent at the time. And suddenly they were all knocking on my door because the New York Times had done this great review and a big article about it. Mm-hmm. And my name was in there. Mm-hmm. And they started to look for who this person was that they hadn't heard from.
Right.
So I got an agent and he said, you got to go to Los Angeles. Otherwise, you're just going to be writing after school specials and you probably right. want to do more than that.
Yeah, yeah,
so,
yeah.
So that's what happened.
Mm. So now you're on the West Coast. Same experience, or you're now at least you've got some money in your pocket?
Well, at that time now I'm married. Okay, so my then husband and I moved to LA, and we tried to duplicate New York by moving into the Melrose area where we could sort of walk.
Right.
And we wound up renting a little house behind the City Cafe. And the City Cafe was very pivotal in changing the LA food culture.
Really?
It was a tiny little place mm-hmm. run by two women. And they, up until then, the food scene in Los Angeles was red sauce Italian and very heavy French.
Right.
And that was it.
This was what, 70s, early 70s?
Now this is
later,
81 when I've okay. now moved to LA.
Okay.
And we're going back and forth. We're trying to keep our apartment in New York.
Yeah.
And, you know. And they were doing such interesting things with food. And, you know, doing things like rhubarb chips. It sounds terrible, but, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, it's the beginning of California cuisine.
Yes.
You know, we're a small cluster of experimental restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't even have a grill. They would grill in the, you know, on a little hibachi in the parking lot, you know. But we would go there three or four times a, you know, a week mm-hmm. For food, and it was great, and it began a more sophisticated palate, I think. So eventually my agents got me a job writing a TV movie, and I then began, you know, being able to afford things like a car.
Which helps in Los Angeles. Yes.
Yeah, it does.
Did you experience, as you were ascending the trail of getting to where you wanted to go, because a lot of your work, particularly, you know, thematically with Murphy Brown, has to do with women bumping against the glass ceiling.
Yeah.
In what way was your personal experience reflective of what you ultimately ended up writing about in that show?
Interestingly enough, I never felt held back by my gender.
And did you feel you were encouraged by men?
Very much so. Very much
right.
encouraged by men, and opened the doors for me. Oftentimes,
mm-hmm.
Murphy was somebody who had already cracked the glass ceiling.
True,
you know.
Yeah.
So I was writing about somebody like my friends and myself, who, you know, in the 80s. Had come through that wave of the feminist movement and were now finding their way in what is still a man's world, you know? So I plucked yep. this character down in the middle of a Washington, D.C. news magazine
mm-hmm.
as the main female anchor. I mean, she was a unicorn in that regard.
Yes.
I just like the idea of somebody being, you know, able to more than make her way in that world, but she was ruling the roost. And I think she was turned out to be embraced by so many women
oh.
because we all wanted to be her.
Yes. And also somebody who spoke her mind.
Yeah. She sometimes didn't have a filter,
yes.
but she did not suffer fools. And
yes.
she was not a people pleaser.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all grow up, all of us gals, we grew up, you know, being people
exactly.
pleasers. And she shed that, you know, and actually rubbed off on both Candace Bergen and myself. We started to take on her characteristics, you know, as the seasons went on.
Right, right. But what a brave and brilliant way of creating this character, rather than making her. I don't want to disparage Mary Tyler Moore, who in her own way was groundbreaking.
Very much so. Yeah.
But the polar opposite of the, at least personality wise.
Yes.
Was there ever any pushback in terms of, oh, you got to make this character less abrasive? You have to make her more likable?
Oh, absolutely. That's the word you hate, is likability, yep. You know, and I created her as a 40-year-old and a recovering alcoholic and a very flawed individual.
Yeah.
And so when I was first pitching this, the request was, can she be 30 instead of 40?
Of course.
And can she just be returning from a spa where she was kind of stressed out instead of the Betty Ford Center? And I said, you know, it's so important to her character to not shave down those edges.
Yeah.
Why don't you let me write a first draft the way I see it? And then if it's, you know, something that you're still afraid of, mm-hmm. then work on it together. And at that time, you know, the networks, the CBS people were like, okay, all right, we'll let you do that.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, you're being on the one hand conciliatory, but on the other hand saying, let me do it my way first.
Yeah, there's a way of handling these things, you know.
Yeah.
And so
a lesson for any listener or aspiring writer out there who feels that their point of view is the only point of view. Your point of view is, but go ahead.
Exactly. And I had already done two series for them. So I think I had earned my stripes with them.
That's true.
And they did trust me to some degree. So I don't think I could have gotten that concession
right
out of the box, you know?
Yeah.
So I did that first draft exactly the way I wanted it. And the day after I handed it in, the writers went on strike.
Oh.
And it turned out to be a very long strike. And so CBS shoots its pilot, all the networks, the linear TV networks shoot their pilots in the spring.
Right.
And the decision had to be made. Are we going to shoot this the way it came out of her typewriter?
Mm-hmm.
Or are we going to wait? And the decision was made to shoot it as it was.
It was
literally a first draft.
Wow. That's extraordinary.
The title Murphy Brown was to me a placeholder because I didn't have a title yet. But it stayed stuck.
Yeah.
And so we shot it exactly as it was. And it was scary, you know, as the creator, because you can't make changes. And, you know, as an actor, you sit around a table and read something and right away things pop out at you that you want to change.
Mm-hmm.
But that the fact that I had a brilliant cast and a brilliant director,
it was an amazing
cast.
It
got us over the hump.
Who directed that episode?
Barnett Kalman, and he directed almost all of the first 100.
Wow,
that was a real bonding experience for all of us because we could only rely on ourselves. Amazingly, I got an Emmy for that script. That was my first Emmy, Best Writing in a Comedy Series. For that first draft. So another lesson is kind of trust your instincts.
Yeah, absolutely.
And a lesson for executives out there, sometimes you need to trust yours too, because, you know, sometimes you just change things and it's just a linear change and it's not making anything better or something worse.
And also, trust the audience.
And trust the audience. Yeah, exactly.
Because audiences are not necessarily a monolith in the sense that they all, the same thing appeals to everybody.
Right.
That we all have varied tastes and we're willing to be led into something new if it's something that has quality. if it's something that's interesting.
That's the key, is the quality.
Yeah.
And we were writing up to our audiences. We were not writing down.
Yes.
We had references to Indira Gandhi in the pilot, to Camus in the pilot. And after the pilot was tested, the research department at CBS said, you know, only 1% of people get these references. We suggest that you not do them in the future. We said, no, that's our trademark, and we're going to do them in the future.
Right.
And if you don't know who Indira Gandhi is, or you don't want to look it up, you know, then, you know, we're not for you.
Yes.
And so we just continued on like that, assuming that our audience was smart. And they were.
And by the way, they were. Yes, exactly.
And, you know, Norman Lear once said, you get the audience you deserve. So, you know, if you are writing down to people and assuming that they're not going to understand anything, that's the audience you deserve. And then you're stuck in that.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. One thing, and I'm sure you're probably tired of hearing about it, but it has to do with the your ability to inject political ideas into the show without any fear of repercussions. But there were there was one particular repercussion that became sort of famous: the Dan Quayle comment about mothers bearing children out of wedlock and fathers and this whole brouhaha that became national news for a time. I'm struck by the fact that, was there any pushback from the network when that was happening?
There wasn't any pushback. By then, we were four seasons into the show.
And a big hit show.
We were a big hit for CBS. They hadn't had a hit show in 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
There were only three networks. Fox was, you know, in its infancy and wasn't even broadcasting every day.
Mm-hmm.
And so they just, at that point, were leaving us alone. They didn't want to mess with anything. And plus, I think they probably felt any publicity is good publicity, and the debate in the country that it ignited during the major presidential campaign went on for an entire summer, and the audience just built, because if you had not been watching that fourth season where Murphy discovered she was pregnant and then made a decision that was very difficult for her, but to have a baby without the dad, and that because the dad didn't want any real participation in it.
And so
in repeats, people went back to see what everybody was talking about.
Yes.
And there wasn't a day that went by that the newspapers weren't commenting on
Remember the time very vividly. Yeah, it was.
In fact, it's in the zeitgeist right now that you and I are talking about this, because I was just in New York doing a long interview with CNN. They're doing a whole hour on this.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's called Tinderbox, and they're doing an hour on a couple of TV shows that, you know, had a very big impact on the culture.
Right.
And this is going to be their lead one. And so it's kind of in the zeitgeist again. And I
Well, and also I think particularly too, because the rescinding of Roe v. Wade by the Supreme Court has become a campaign issue, has become a national issue that has not necessarily divided us, has really sort of brought the subject back up again. And I'm not going to get on the soapbox here, but but your rejoinder to Vice President Quayle, or at the time, the vice president candidate, right? He was a candidate at the time.
They were running for re-election.
Ah, that's what it was.
Yeah.
But your rejoinder to him was very, quite brilliant, I think. It had to do, could you remember it?
I can't quote it verbatim, but, you know, I basically said that, you know, if you don't think that a single woman like her is capable of raising a child, then you better make sure that abortion remains safe and legal.
Mm-hmm.
So just, you know, crystallized the hypocrisy of running on an anti-choice platform and then criticizing this fictional character.
Yes.
for, you know, everything under the sun, including being responsible for the LA riots and, you know, the breakdown of the moral fabric
of the entire Western civilization. Right.
Exactly. And so, you know, that's, it's just, it still amazes me that, you know, this was a fictional character that, touched all this off. But I think it was important because it got the country talking about something that people weren't really focusing that much
absolutely.
On.
Absolutely.
And I think it kind of turned the election a little bit, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was really, there was a lot of backtracking that had to happen by George Bush, original recipe Bush. Mm-hmm. And we wound up on the front page of the New York Times above the fold. Mm-hmm. Full picture, Murphy holding the baby. Hill on one side. But, you know, I mean, it was phenomenal, really.
Oh, it was an extraordinary moment, really.
Yeah.
In many, many ways. I will leave that somewhat controversial subject. To me, it's not controversial, but to some people it is. To return a little bit to food and sort of glide into our conclusion, because first of all, now, do you cook now? And if you do, you said you discovered a great deal as you were moving along in your career.
Yeah, I definitely cook. I'm actually a good home cook, mm-hmm. a very good home cook. I love making dinner parties, you know, wherever I am. I usually have a lot of people around my table, mm-hmm. and the kitchen's a mess, and doing it tonight.
Great. What are you cooking?
You know what? I'm just going to light the grill because it's a beautiful night out, and the sweet corn is in season. So I'm going to do, I think, some local sausage and peppers and onions on the grill in a good bun and corn and some kind of tomato salad. Oh. And, you know, it's easy peasy. There's nothing complicated about that meal at all.
No, but at the same time, healthy and delicious.
Yeah. Yeah. You take, I mean, where I am now in Martha's Vineyard, it's a, you know, growing season and it's just every farm stand has the most delicious stuff in the farmers markets. And you just want to take advantage of that.
Exactly.
You know? And you don't want to be lighting the oven and, you know, standing over a hot stove too long. So
now I always conclude with a question for my guests. If there is one moment in your life, be it a childhood moment or as you moved along in your life, that you remember so vividly because there was a taste or a smell of food, or something that pertained to food in which when you experience it again, it takes you back to that first time in your life.
It doesn't necessarily have to be a good taste,
not at all.
As you were describing this, I'm immediately thinking of that block of fish. And last night for dinner, I had fish and chips, you know, which is the complete antithesis of what that fish was. And I swore that I would never eat fish after experiencing. That was my only experience of fish. And I thought that's what all fish
was
this whole foul smelling. And then discovered, there's some really delicious fish out there.
Yeah.
And now fish is probably the biggest part of my diet, but especially here in the vineyard, it just comes right out of the ocean.
Oh, yeah. So, absolutely.
You know, like almost every day I have fish, but yeah, it was like a bad taste memory that has now turned into one of my favorite things. So
perfect. Well, I'm also going to at some point pepper you for a recipe because we post recipes. Guest favorite recipes, either from their childhood or from their adulthood, we put on my website. So I hope you'll join us with that. And Diane English, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, thank you for having me, Chris. This is super fun.
Yeah, it's been such a pleasure to revisit our relationship because I haven't seen you in a long time.
Yeah.
Full disclosure, I was a guest at one point on one of the episodes of Love and War many years
ago.
When my wife Joanna was a regular on the show. A little
That's
nepotism
right.
in there.
Yes.
And
worked out great.
Yeah,
though.
And I look forward to talking to you again.
Yes, in person.
Yes,
and
exactly.
We'll have dinner, and I'll cook.
Okay, it's a deal. Thank you, Diane English.
Bye.